So I'm incredibly happy about all this. The news being that BuzzFeed and Vice both get in the bullet. And I am, Nah, I'm not even going to pretend to be slightly upset about anyone's career here. I am pretty darn happy. And the reason being that, well, Carl will say to me usually whenever there's some big bust up, you know, some left-wing media outlet goes bust and people lose their jobs. And he won't actually get all that happy about it because he'll be like, well, you know, it's still sad, all these people losing their jobs. That could be us one day or something. No, it isn't, because there's a difference between people losing jobs where, you know, it's the economy or whatever, and then complete scumbag liars who spend the position of power that they had for a brief moment doing the worst possible things they could and trying to destroy friends of mine. And frankly, those people can go to hell. I don't care. I have absolutely no such sympathy for them. And the reason they try to destroy friends of mine, their lives, try and make them homeless and get rid of their income streams, was because they had a political disagreement. They disagree with you politically. So I'm going to get you demonetized on YouTube and make sure you end up, you know, because you're completely unemployable because of all the smear pieces that run against you, Dankula, then we're going to try and destroy your life. A human being who does that, especially to someone like Count Dankula, who did nothing wrong, is just beyond the pale, in my opinion, for any kind of sympathy. I don't have it. I don't have it in me, and I'm not going to pretend I do. And we'll start off by promoting something on LotusEaters.com, being Susan Wojcicki, explaining why she ruined YouTube, which was a bad move. But Susan is a kind of person who messed up because she got her own feelings involved and decided that YouTube should not be a place where you have fun, but instead where I tell you what you should see, which was bad. But she was not an evil individual trying to purposely ruin people's lives because I disagree with him politically. I mean, just grow up. Just grow up, for Christ's sake. But these people were. Because if we go to the next one here, we have BuzzFeed and the news there. They're going to hell, which couldn't have come soon enough. Not even slightly upset about it. I mean, the disdain that journalists have in all of the Anglosphere, I can't think of a single Anglo nation that doesn't just hate their journo class, is because of the actions the journos took and earned that hate with those actions. Yeah. This has not come out of the ether, but suddenly everyone was like, you know what, I hate news. You know what, I hate news. People telling me what's going on in the world. Oh, I can't stand those folks. The town crier. I mean, everyone hated him, right? No, it was these types of individuals who decided, what is my job in this position of privilege I have of being able to work at BuzzFeed? Well, it's to ruin people and their families. That's what they thought their jobs were. And I can prove it. I mean, we have the names. We'll start off here with the news coming from this article here, saying, there was early on at BuzzFeed a thin but novel ideology at work, on top of the usual folk wisdom about traffic and audiences and news and scoops. It was color-coded in the stats attached to every post and scored as a metric called viral lift. Social traffic was good traffic created and validated by readers choosing to share the articles. The rest of the traffic from searches and portals are dead, but ever-growing front page sites nonsense. Might as well have been fake. So the point was, share the stuff. If it shares a lot, it's good. People see it on the front page, doesn't matter. Someone reads it, doesn't matter. Yeah. What we're here for is viral lift. And this is the thing that made BuzzFeed cancer, because they were no longer interested in, was it good? Was it good content? Did it help people? No. What was interesting is it got viral lift. So if you make a smear piece. Yeah. And this is where you get the nonsense of rage bait, where I do a terrible thing and then publish it. And oh, look, there's all these views on the terrible thing I did. So yeah, I mean, if you kill a bunch of kids, you'll be on the news. A lot of people will know your name, but you're a scumbag. Like, you kill kids. So if you do something terrible on the internet, like, oh, I don't know, trying to get YouTubers their entire lives ruined, and then boast about it, how you were so successful in doing it, and you get a bunch of, normal people who are watching this and being like, what the hell's wrong with you? That's not good. Maybe a lot of eyeballs. That's because you're terrible. I just don't understand how they didn't seem to think that this was going to be the end. BuzzFeed's sudden ascent had turned Jonah, one of the people in this article who cares about, into someone of the industry's oracle, and what happened had been a slippery, evolving pitch to investors and interviewers turned into a new conventional wisdom for publishers, many of whom didn't seem to notice that BuzzFeed's actual news operation, not its list of quizzes and social clever media experiments, and blah, 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 the other crap they did that no one paid about. You know, they're like lol, funny, but who cares, right? No, the big bad that BuzzFeed did in the world was its newsroom, and they were saying, oh no, it's a traditional newsroom. The plan for its newsroom, that had always been a sensitive subject, was never clearly anything but a subsidiary of the organization, because it didn't make any money. Never made any money. no rich person's buying newspapers. I mean, a shock. If you're looking to invest, yeah, news, not one of them. It's just not really the big profitable place. Oil, that might be on the up and up. I don't know. But yeah, the idea here was that, no, you have a newsroom. What do you use it? Well, we use it to go after our political opponents because we have a disagreement. So let's destroy them instead. And we can see this. We got Count Dankula. I mean, this is him posting about it back in the day, where BuzzFeed decided to run a bunch of smear jobs on him, calling him Nazi man, blah, blah, blah. And then being like, how does he make money on YouTube? And then tagging YouTube, being like, how can you give Nazi man money? That's bad. Look, he's Nazi man. How do we know this? Well, we've written 10 articles calling him Nazi man.
Is that, what's the law? They say that if...
Godwin's law?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, he did exactly. Do the whole Nazi pug thing. Yeah, so yeah, that's yeah, yeah. Not really Godwin's law there. Okay. But it's the point being that Dankula, decent guy, didn't do anything wrong. BuzzFeed came after him specifically because they just didn't like him. Yeah. And did try to destroy... Well, they successfully destroyed his income stream on YouTube by getting him demonetized. Go to hell. Go to hell. I mean, he's just awful human beings who would do that to an innocent guy who's done nothing wrong. Oh, what did he do? Oh, he told a joke, did he? He told an edgy joke. It was too much for you. Pissing your pants over, oh no, man-made joke on the internet. I'm sorry, like these are not average people in industry who lose their jobs because of economic factors. These are people who, when they had a position of power, did the worst possible thing they could have. I mean, just going after innocent people. If you got the next one here, we also have TR, who got banned. Remember, they also went after him as well. You see that name, Mark DiStefano, which we'll come back to. You can also have them going over Carl as well, where they tried to smear him constantly, because of course... Little old Mark there, again, for some reason. Well, Mark used to be one of the head smear merchants. This is literally all he did.
So basically character assassination.
Yeah, for the purpose of trying to ruin people's livelihoods.
Yeah.
That's a good job. That's a good part of the world. Thanks for that. Really making the world a better place. Well, he ended up leaving that complete dumpster fire of an organization and tried to get a proper job. He went to the Financial Times to actually write about things instead of just smear pieces and instantly got fired. I don't know if you remember this.
So no, this is, but let's see.
This is the guy who got Count Dankula demonetized. He went over to the Financial Times and then instantly joined a leading opposition's group's Zoom call where they were doing layoffs and started live tweeting the layoffs that were not public.
Oh, that's not good.
So the Financial Times went, buddy, that's corporate espionage. You're fired. You can't do that. That's not within the ethics conduct.
Well, they say something about people who don't like playing by the rules and...
Yeah. No. But the point being that BuzzFeed attracted these kinds of terrible people. And as soon as they interacted with anywhere else in the world that actually had even the modicum of ethical standards that a mainstream newspaper does. I mean, they don't have much ethical standards. And even they were like, oh, get out. We can't be dealing with you. And he had to leave. And of course, Vice is now, the news come out, that they're going the same way. They're going bankrupt and deserved. If we get the next one here, we can see that news there, that Vice is said to be heading for bankruptcy. This is not confirmed, sadly. So the news here is that they used to be valued at $5.7 billion, which is pretty good. But then by people on the inside, they say that the accounts are a tiny fraction of that now.
Okay.
Ripperoo. Anyway, point being that they're looking for a buyer, so they might find one. If you have billions of dollars, don't give it to Vice. I don't know how many billionaires we have in the audience, but
why would they want the name?
Yeah, it's more that why would you want to resuscitate the local child rapist? Metaphorically here, like just the worst member of the media community. He's passing out, is he? He might die if you don't give him CPR. Oh, that's a shame. All right, bye. I'm not
good riddance
in the slightest sympathetic. And the big thing for me here that makes me pissed off with Vice is, of course, and most people online, is Vice used to be good. That old meme. Because it's true. I mean, if you can go back, just that article, just give us a scroll. Because where you have the Vice building, it's a picture. And then the next picture is of Shane over here. Shane was an interesting guy.
Yeah.
Stars one of the co-founders there. And Vice, a lot of other people as well, who were good and interesting and ended up leaving. Which I think if we had the list, it would be too damn long, but you all know who you are. Thank you for your service. But if we get the next one here, you can see Shane. I'm going to focus on Shane because I just liked some of Shane's videos especially. I mean, this is one of the old episodes, 11 years old now. North Korean labor camps.
Okay.
That's interesting as hell. And what is it? It's Shane on the Trans-Siberian Railway getting pissed as a bunch of Russian hoodlums come over, being like, trying to make friends. Average Russian interaction here. Bro, you're a Jew telling me to be nice. Which, that's funny. Yeah. But they go to the North Korean labor camps and show off that they exist in Russia. really interesting journalism, really interesting on-screen interactions.
Oh, look at how people cheer one another.
Yeah, but
how they toast, bro. How are you?
But if you get the next one here, it's not just the North Korean stuff that everyone remembers. I mean, like this. I mean, that's a title, isn't it? The Cannibal Generals of Liberia. Yeah, I want to see the Cannibal Generals of Liberia. That's goddamn awesome. I want to check that out. And this is what made Vice the international darling of the early years of being really cool. Because it was actually interesting. And, well...
What happened? What happened, I wonder? Well, does it have to do with anything, with an internal bureaucracy that went political and said...
People like Shane were taken off to off-screen roles. Got to do stuff behind the scenes, boys, and then they really reappeared. Yeah, he was too busy not being on screen. And then you had the other people who, realized this is cancer because of the people in charge, I'm leading. And fair enough. Because, well, what replaced this good content? Well, it wasn't good content. It was bad content. You kept going to this restaurant. They kept giving you amazing meals, and then they started feeding you gruel. Leftist gruel. The worst kind of gruel. If we go to the next one here, we can see it. This is this doughboy over here. I don't know if you've seen this video. It's just actually pathetic, this individual. He went to a reenactors event. I think this is in Kent or something. Yeah, give that a dislike. Yeah, give it a click. Screw that guy. Yeah. This is the Reich reenactors. And the whole thing is a bunch of reenactors. Some of them play the goodies, of course, the allies, and some of them play the baddies, the Axis. And he spends the whole time being like, dressing as a Nazi, that's pretty edgy.
Oh,
ooh, you could be a Nazi secretly, couldn't you? Isn't that pretty edgy? It's like, bro.
Sorry, if that's the level of journalism, they shouldn't have the position on the first place.
On a journalistic level, obviously ridiculous, waste of time. Many a reaction video were made to this at the time being like, this is garbage. What is Vice doing?
Yeah.
Which is all fair. But on a side note, I just can't get over how this little doughboy is like, you know what, this organization that goes to North Korea and Liberia and hangs out with cannibals and communists and murderers.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what else is edgy? People wearing the Nazi uniform at a reenactment. Ooh, isn't that edgy? It's like, this is the most boring crap I've ever heard.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know, you're at a cocaine and hookers party and some guy turns up and he's like, you know what, I'm going to stay up past my bedtime.
Yeah.
Are you now? Ooh, feeling spicy today, are we, son? Whatever. Just crap. Five spooky for me. There's also the next one here. This is more of the modern stuff, of the stuff that replaced it, which is also crap.
Oh, come on. Just the title.
Yeah.
Just see the title. I'm sure
you know
it's going to
be...
Yeah.
Give that a dislike. Come on. No, don't give it a like. Give it a dislike. There we are. Do your service. As we are.
Yeah.
I mean, people can see the dislike ratios as well. They're not small. Here we have, for people listening, transphobic influencers are driving a violent groomer conspiracy, decade of hate. I mean, you can already tell it's garbage.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
It's just going to be garbage. And you can see this, the image here as well. There's some guy who looks like a sex offender, sat in his basement, telling you about how everything's fine, what the left is doing is okay, don't worry about your children.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, not convincing. Crap content as well. And also, what happened? What, like, dudes used to go to Afghanistan and Ukraine. What the hell is this? You're sitting in your basement being like, you know what's actually also very cool and edgy? Dressing up in women's uniform and dancing with your cock out in front of kids. No, bro. Not based. Cringe, in fact. Go home. Go to jail. Do not pass go. Maybe. What the hell's wrong with you? And
they definitely try to present the other side as being behind it.
Yeah.
Just look at the title, yeah.
You know what we're going to do? We're going to go speak to the right-wingers who think that maybe you shouldn't dance with your cock out in front of kids. Yeah. What should we do? We're editing this. What should we do with that footage? I don't know. Let's put some spooky music over the background. And then when it's the left-wingers, put some happy-go-fun music that's royalty-free.
Yeah.
I mean,
or do one of those videos where they had people who were witnesses and something, parties and with a mask.
Yeah.
But yeah, I witnessed.
It's just comically bad, even on the editing level, never mind the subject matter, never mind the journalistic integrity. Yeah. And when you have that compared to the fellas who are going out to Sudan to go and hang out with the military and show you how that's going, I mean, I'd be embarrassed to be in the same organization. I mean, there's just such a depth between the people doing the interesting stuff there and advice that we're still, I mean, even to the end of it. There's one guy I follow who stayed with them and was going to, like, the Ukrainian conflict and hang out with neo-Nazis. That's cool. I want to see that.
Yeah.
And then he did one where he went to Mali and hanged out with the French military, hunting down jihadists on the front line. And then he went to Syria and hung out with ISIS. I mean, that's just like coolest thing in the world. And it's him showing you, yeah, this is what these people really believe firsthand, instead of the like dry BBC lecture to camera that they'd usually do. And then you're sharing space with this local man telling you that, you know, that groomer stuff, that's not really happening. I mean, it's just sad. And you can see the political bias just in the like search terms. I know it's a meme at this point, but it's not a wrong meme, is my point. We got the next one here. We can see you look up far right. There's a tag there, of course. Lot of stories. Big old stories. 50-something pages of stories, actually. There you are, 57 pages of stories of the far right.
Just for one day.
No, it's over there, period of articles.
I'm surprised they didn't put more.
But the point being that occasionally, yeah, they'll hang out with like Ukrainian Nazis or American Nazis or something, and that's, you know, Nazis, fair enough. Kyle Rittenhouse? No. No, well, not really what I call the far right.
He didn't allow himself to be killed.
Yeah, that's far right. It's just embarrassing. I mean, and then Marjorie Taylor Greene, it's just like, okay, cringe. This is why you have your leftist reputation. And we can see it even clearer if you just go and look up the far left term instead. You want to see how many stories in their entire history of Vice?
Three.
Yeah, no, there's a few more than that. There's one page, which you can see, like, the original article there's from 2015.
They said something about Greece, last row.
Yeah, because they actually would go and find some leftists.
Penultimate row.
I think this is back when there was no money. So there were some leftists doing the leftist thing, they do. But it's just, okay, they stopped covering that in 2017 as well. It's like, right.
Well, the far left has been normalized.
The political bias is demonstrable and easy to demonstrate.
Yeah.
I mean, the funniest one back, well, not funny, kind of cringiest, was when they did an interview with a local terrorist who was justifying terrorism after he shot a guy wearing a MAGA hat in the head.
Yeah.
For wearing a MAGA hat. And then they interview this dude, and the headline here is, he acted in self-defense, I swear. And the day after he did this interview, the police found him, you know, for murder, and told him to come out of the building with his hands up. So he opened fire on the police, as an innocent man would, who was pleading that he acted in self-defense. So the police shot him to death, of course. Anyway, it's just, yeah, this is how Vice became crap. I mean, just demonstrably. There's actually a fella, the one I mentioned I've been following, he published an article just before I went live. I didn't have time to add it, but I read it, in which he was mentioning that all of a sudden, after doing all the really edgy, cool stuff, what happened is they purged a bunch of the old journalists that had made them what they were, because they don't really need you anymore, and hired a bunch of corpos.
Yeah.
Okay, great. We've got some bodies to make.
We need
content.
Strategic vision now. We need to become a political organization engaging in character assassination.
Or just making up stuff, as you can see here. Are you familiar with bullets? Do you know how a bullet works?
Yeah.
I think most people, even outside of America, know what a bullet looks like. There it is. You know, you fire the whole bullet, including... this is more bullet than normal bullets, because it's, as you can see there, for people listening, we're looking at an image from a Vice article that says high-caliber bullet poked out of one of the gates outside some shootout in Mexico. And not only have they got the bullet part of the bullet, they've got the rest of the bullet, you know, the bit that you don't fire, attached in the bullet hole. So what happened, clearly, is someone at Vice went to this place after the shootout, picked up a bullet, and shoved it in the hole for, I don't know, visual representation, in case you didn't know that holes were made by bullets. It's just embarrassing. Not to mention they would also just publish fake news. There is a game, I mean, there's one guy here who did play that game, where he just called Vice, made up something fake, and then they published it.
Yep.
Now you can see the story here being, we spoke to a guy who got his dick locked in a cage by a hacker. No, that didn't happen. 100% fake. You are fools. I don't know how else to put it. But if we get the next one here, I mean, what would humanity do without Vice, though? Let's give them their hearing. The steel man position.
Yeah.
What would we do without such journalism as How to Make Breakfast with Your Vagina? I mean, I know this has also become a meme, rightfully so. Because as you purged all the interesting journos and hired a bunch of corpos, they wrote this. Janet J over here, who I don't think is ever going to go to Syria and do anything interesting. I think what she's going to do is write about making breakfast with her vagina, which you should feel embarrassed to be next to.
Maybe I'll read that article, just out of curiosity.
No, don't. Go outside and... Yeah.
Do something productive.
No.
Seize the day.
Do nothing productive, and you will have done more than Janet, I think. We'll go to the next one, because the meme is absolutely real. I mean, this has been shared for years, of course. You know, Vice then. I would go to the most war-torn places on Earth to expose the dirty politics. Now, 10 reasons why SpongeBob is homophobic. Yeah, this is just real, demonstrable, and I can show it. There's also CNN, who are not exactly the best and brightest. I just want to point out, this isn't a unique problem to BuzzFeed and Vice, who are like the up-and-comers in the internet age. No. Like, all left-wing media is cancer. This is a map of the British Empire in 1922. Stelios, as the non-British man, could you spot a problem or two, perhaps, with this elegant map put together by the finest scholars of CNN? Please tell me you can, or I'm going to be disappointed.
Just tell me, because...
Oh, come on! You see that big bit of Canada that's missing, for example, from the British Empire? Yeah. I don't know, it's all of a sudden we own Indonesia for no reason? Saudi Arabia, that was part of the British Empire, wasn't it? Also, what is that, Burkina Faso? Or one of those African countries that no one can name? Oh, it is the one that no one can name, because you'll get banned.
Very mixed with the dates.
It's just all kinds of wrong for some reason. I don't know why we own Italian Somalia as well. I take no responsibility for that. Point being, these people are crap at their jobs. They're not good at the best times. And being a midwit who made that map is one thing. Being a scumbag who goes after Count Dankula to try and make his wife, himself, and his kids homeless is despicable. And I have no sympathy for that person. We'll get to the next bit, though, because I want to just promote some good journalism, which is not by journalists. It's community notes.
I just saw the lady and...
Yeah, you get disappointed.
Yeah.
And scared. No, so this is a tweet where we have, you know, the diversity hire at the White House saying that immigration is down 90%. It's an obvious lie. And you can see the community notes pointing out, that's an obvious lie. Yeah. It's the truth. But the really messed up thing about this tweet here is not a lady tells lie at White House. If you scroll back up, Town Hall over here just presented this lie as truth. Here's a direct quote. I know we're meant to be journalists at Town Hall, but we're not going to bother.
Yeah.
Not going to bother. No, instead we'll just parrot what the government says. And this is what too much of the media is. It's just the government said this. It's like, why the hell do you exist then? I could go and read that from the government website.
And they do something worse. They engage in smearing. And for instance, they engage smearing. And for instance, when people are proven innocent of what they were accused of, they just will have a short asterisk at the end of the page saying, well,
if they can be honest.
Yeah, yeah. But what was the Gable saying? Throw mud. Some of it will stick.
Yeah. But the new frontier of journalism is not only not from the journalists, but instead rando Twitter users on doing community notes. It's also incredibly good, actually probably the best new form of journalism in our lifetimes. I don't think if anything's ever going to get better, because the structure of this is something no one has sat around and really appreciated how good. So I want to just sit around with your folks and appreciate it. Get the next link here. See some more of that, because we have
guys again.
Yeah, you know, the community notes coming in and being like, hang on a minute. Local man says he's not paid by the DNC, but takes 200 grand by the DNC. I mean, I'd call that payment, but never mind. So White House shills getting exposed. Good news. If you have the next one here, we have Reuters, who decided to do an interview with Adolf from a Ukrainian regiment that named itself after the SS. He's a patriotic fellow, I'm sure. That's how they presented it. Community notes were like, hang on a minute, maybe Adolf over here is not just your average Ukrainian serviceman who's fighting for his independence. Maybe Adolf, not a very common name in Ukraine, might have some other inspirations for why he's doing what he does. And as you can see there, get wrecked, Reuters, you pathetic individuals, who would just be like, oh yeah, average Ukrainian man, Adolf McSwastika. It's like, no, that's not the average Ukrainian man. That's quite a small part of the average Ukrainian. Yeah. We'll get the next one here. We also have lying unions who are caught out in their lies. This is great. Just being like, I was arguing to open up the schools during the pandemic. Community notes, not so agreeable. And with links to prove why she's wrong and she is a shill for shutting down the schools and ruining your kids' lives. We also have the Labour Party, who have been caught this morning just making up stuff. I love this. This would never have happened before Elon Musk, and everyone knows it. You have the Labour Party here being like, oh yeah, vote for us tomorrow. I think it's today when this goes out on YouTube, the local elections. Go out and vote if you want. Take your ID. Do the funny thing. I don't know. I'm not voting for LibLabCon, that's for sure. But if you go down, we can see there's a community note. Oh, there was a community note. Don't know where it's gone. Maybe it's not loaded properly or something, but there is one. There's just like, they're lying. Because the quote here is, yeah, we'll stop the rise in council tax. And just the community knows that literally can't be done if they win the local elections.
I really find it funny when I see Labour supporters trashing Starmer.
Yeah.
It's just funny.
But I just, I absolutely love that the new world of journalism is actually on your side. Here's the truth. And what is it made by? Is it made by the class of journos with their holy check marks? No, it's made by us plebs. Just us plebs collaborating on trying to find an accurate description of the truth. If you get the next one here as well, we can see something that is the absolute best. And the reason I am doubly happy today, Mehdi Hassan getting shat on by the community notes. A lot of people cover this, but I don't want to enjoy. So if people are listening, he puts out this crappy clip where he says, white people kill other white people at almost the exact same rate black people kill other black people. In the United States, of course, because he's moved over there, because he's a laughing stock in the UK. He says, and yet you never hear anyone complaining about white-on-white crime. Yeah, for some reason. Those aren't the points of sage wisdom from Marr. They are classic racist dog whistles. And before Musk, this would have been another day, another smear from some checkmark who could get away with it because the system was on his side. Now, look at that, little community notes. According to the FBI, crime statistics, it turns out that, no. Yeah, it turns out black-on-black crime, quite a bit bigger, quite a bit more deadly, quite a bit more, I don't know, unrepresentative of the statistics, and white-on-white crime, not representative. In fact, white's far less likely to kill each other. There you are, according to the FBI. And the doubly cool bit about this, of course, is that community notes are anonymous.
Yeah.
So we can finally have difficult conversations that would never have been allowed before. I mean, he gets double community noted there, where he's tried to save it because he got community noted by posting some article being like, oh, look, they're the same, I swear. It's just a lie.
Then you'll have people saying that this is all made up.
No, instead, you literally have everyone being like...
No, I'm not saying people aren't there. I mean, I'm saying from the other side.
Oh, maybe, but they've been completely drowned out.
Yeah.
By this new world of journalism. Yeah. People being like, crime statistic posting time. And I thought we'd end this off with the best part, which is how butthurt Mehdi Hassan is, the most butthurt man on Drury Lane. As you can see here, he says, if you had any doubt the community notes would become another weapon of the right on Musk's Twitter, see the BS community note added to my Bill Maher clip after the MAGA folks demanded it. Okay, it makes a point that's irrelevant to the one I'm making about the rates of killing. And then he gets community noted again. But people being like, no, community notes aren't from the MAGA guys. It's literally by the community. We have to rate each other's stuff to make sure it's not one-sided. And suck some eggs, you lying smear merchant. No, yeah, it is the case that black people in the United States are killing each other far more than white people. But it's not people, is it? It's black men of a certain age and white men of a certain age that make up those numbers. But that conversation could never have happened, especially so publicly, and especially so in the face of the journo class before Musk. So there we have it. A lot of old media, legacy smear merchant media, is dead, and the new version is literally just a community notes tab, which has done far more good for the world than those people ever did in their time of privilege. If you appreciated that segment from the podcast The Lotus Eaters, you can go to lotuseaters.com to get access to all the premium content that's on the site, such as the Symposium series, this episode on the politics of Aristotle Part 1. If you'd like to find out what else is being put out, you can follow on Getter at lotuseaters_com on Getter. Thank you and goodbye.